when a housewife's the wigs are all messed up. They don't get it together to season two.
Oh, I'm Doree. As long as I'm Doree, I'm okay.
This is the remix.
I wish you'd bring her back.
The Jeep,
so
this new remix.
All right, beware the quick brightness on stage, everyone. Beware.
You tell us.
They can. Welcome to Stab Comedy Theater. It's time for LOL GBT Plus presents Say Yas. Welcome to the stage. Already on stage, your cast for Say Yas. I told you.
Hello, Stab audience. How are you? My name's Suzette Veneti, and it's been like a year since the last Suzette Veneti show almost. This is not that. This is a show called Say Yas. And joining me live in the audience are Apple Adams.
Thank you, all four of you. Thank you.
Yayah. And for the first time live in the Stab studio, Clifton Ellison.
Hey, y'all.
So anyway, this show, what we're going to do is we're going to answer questions about, mostly about, it's you could translate it to like comedy if you want to, but this is about drag topics. And so for this first episode, we're going to answer the question, should every drag performer produce their own show? So, and there's just going to be a lot of exposition in this first episode, just for people watching. So for every episode, we're going to have either a yes, a no, or a maybe, right? And then should we start with our qualifications before we answer?
Sure.
Okay. Apple, what are your qualifications to answer this question?
Well, I am a drag queen, so we're going to start with that. I've been doing it for 9.5 years now in Sacramento, which means I am both old and seasoned. I've seen a lot of drag shows begin and die in Sacramento, and I know what it takes to run a drag show, even though I am often blackout drunk during my own.
Round of applause for Apple Adams, please.
Thank you. I deserve it. Thank you.
Yaya, what are your qualifications to answer this question?
I've been doing drag now in Sacramento for 6 years, and I produce my own show at Punchline called Nightcap, and we've sold out every single month since we started. So I know all about production, baby.
Clifton, you're not a drag queen.
Not.
But you are so knowledgeable. Tell us your qualifications for answering this question.
I have been in these streets for about 15, 16 years, and I have worked in Badlands between being a dancer and a DJ, so I have seen many shows come and go, many hosts come and go, many performers come and go. And I think I have the qualifications to speak on this.
Oh, I think you do too. It's I wasn't challenging. You're here for a reason. And my name's Suzette Veneti. I don't know if you guys know me. Last show I did here, nobody knew what a Suzette Veneti was. It's okay.
We still don't.
The Proud Boys do. That's fine. They hate me. But I actually produce. That's kind of what I do. Is I'm like a pathological producer. I'm just like, oh, that's it. Actually, that's how this show started. The three of us were in the dressing room at Badlands, and we were just like, what if there was a drag talk show and we answered important questions? And I was like, that's a show. Like, yeah. Can you vouch for how awful I am?
Yeah, you're pretty bad.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
Literally, anyway. Someone could stub their toe on a heel. You'd be like, oh my God, that's a show. It's like, no.
No.
Oh my God, it's called Ouch.
Yeah, we're making our debut at Eschaton next month.
Yeah. Yeah. It's not even a joke. I was joking with a friend the other day when we were talking about a show, and I was like, oh my God, we can't have a stupid name like Bus Stop. And then I was like, wait, Bus Stop is a listen, you get, like, the audience gets on at the first stop. And then we go, like, and I do the intros, right? And then at the next stop, Yaya gets on, and I'm like, Yaya! And then she does a number until the next stop, and she gets off, and Apple gets on, and I'm like, Apple Adams! And then she does a number until the next stop, and then the next performer. Is that not a show you want
to
see?
Putting your tax dollars to work.
Bus Stop.
So, wait, I'm gonna interject there. Please, you're going to have a bunch of really tall men in dresses in heels on a moving bus try to perform?
Ladies. Dresses, yeah.
Ladies, you're right.
Yeah.
No. No, a solid no.
Well, then you're not in it. Whatever.
Good. Thank you.
Speaking of producing shows, that's the topic of the day, is should every drag performer produce their own show? So let's get a quick temperature on that. We'll just go round table and say yes, no, or maybe. So.
I'm going to give a solid maybe.
Okay.
That's where I'm at with it.
I was going to say no, but I'm going to give a maybe.
I'm going to say no.
Okay.
No.
Okay. All right, so let's open this up because we have some maybes and some no's. I think right now in Sacramento, and you guys can talk whenever you want. It's not the Suzette Veneti show. That was a show. There are so many drag shows. There are I think tonight there were four, five, too many. We have an audience, so if you can't hear the audience, I'm gonna parrot what they say. So we just heard too many. There were four shows.
You know, and let's ask here. Has anybody seen a drag show here in Sacramento? No. Okay. They are everywhere right now.
You can trip over them.
Yeah. There's literally drag 7 days a week now.
Oh, yeah.
Is there?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Oh, yeah. Because Tuesday.
Every day.
What's Wednesday?
Pink Wednesday.
Right. Okay. Drag shows every... So, I mean, later, I got to ask you guys why you came tonight. If you've never seen a drag show, that's amazing. Thank you for coming. Appreciate our studio audience. Thank you so much.
You know, let's make them uncomfortable right now. We just go one by one, why are you here? Why are you here?
That's actually riveting for the audience watching on the streaming, yeah. I'm sure they'll love it, and they'll love it. Yeah, that's great. You don't know if you'd love it? But isn't that America today? Let's get some men to tell women what they love. And make you love it. No, I'm joking. I'm not that person. I'm a lady anyway. It's lady to lady. So there's so many drag shows. It's tough because we love drag, obviously. We do drag. We want there to be drag shows. Why is too many drag shows a problem, Clifton?
It's because when there's an oversaturation, it doesn't feel special anymore. Like, for example, if there were, I'm trying to give a good analogy for it. Sorry, she's been drinking. But if there was a concert, say for instance, if Barbara Streisand was in town,
yes,
and
please.
If she was doing a residency in Sacramento, but then you have Barbara Streisand here, and then you have Liza Minnelli over here, and you have Lady Gaga over here, and they're doing two shows a day, 7 days a week, all together. After a while, it would be like, okay, girl, I done seen this show, I done seen this girl many times, and the thrill kind of dies a little bit. So when there's too many drag shows, the fun and the spark and making it feel special kind of goes away because, like, okay, girl, if I don't see her on Sunday, I'll see her on Monday, I'll see her on Tuesday, I'll see her whatever day of the week that I can. And you know, when I first started going out, there were only two drag shows. There was the Downtown Divas at Faces, and then there was Fridays Are a Drag at Badlands. That was only once a month. So those shows felt special. And I'm nothing against the multiple shows because every show has a different kind of purpose it brings. Like, you know, the Monday show is where the girls come that want to try out and get their feet wet. And then, you know, we had, well, we used to have a Latin show on Wednesday, and then we have the Thursday shows and the Friday show. So they all kind of brought a little something different, but after a while, it's kind of just like, okay, I'm not going to stretch myself out to go to every show because eventually I'm going to see one of y'all somewhere. And I feel like when there's too many, then people might just start to kind of have that same kind of like, okay, girl, I'll see them when I see them. Then that's money out of your pocket, and that's less people in the seats. Whereas, like, if it was a once-a-month show or every other week show with a different cast, then that would make it feel a little bit more special.
I think you touched on some really important topics there. Maybe diversifying your cast, maybe diversifying your show. Because I just want to say... and you guys don't know me, right? We established that?
No,
I'm sorry.
No,
I've been drinking
you, no.
Also. I don't know what just happened. Am I blonde or brunette right now? I can't tell. Thank you. I'm a blonde. And so I, because I am a pathological show producer, I should admit, full transparency, I have no less than 6 shows that I produce currently. So why the fuck, who am I to sit up here and say, like, there's too many shows? But one thing I do is I diversify where my shows are and how my shows exist. Like what type of show they are. So like this is unlike any other drag show that exists in Sacramento currently. This is just, if we can get paid to sit here and talk, then God bless us, right? But Other drag shows, I think what I'm seeing are a lot of showcases, and there's they feel duplicative. Is that kind of what we're feeling?
Well, I'm going to ask you a really important question. Please. What is duplicative?
Duplicative means the same as something else.
Oh, okay. I'm not qualified enough to answer that yet, so y'all go first.
Okay.
Yes and no. I feel like there are definitely drag shows like angled more towards like alternative drag and more towards different styles of drag, and then there's like themed events too where people showcase different ideas and concepts. So like I appreciate that because there's a lot of things that I've wanted to do for a long time that now I can do. But then it's also like the longevity of these shows is kind of up in the air because it's like you start a new show and it obviously gets really good attention right out of the gate. It's a new venue, it's a new place. Your audience is, you know, curious to see how it goes, so they show up. And then it looks like it was really successful because the first one was really successful. So then you start another show. And then you start another show. And you just have like new show. And nothing's like gaining traction. You're just kind of popping up new stuff in other places. And it's just like, how sustainable is that? You know, at what point do these venues burn out and the performers burn out and these producers burn out?
Right, so that's important because you covered venues. So we have to be careful with the venues that we do the shows at as producers. Like, it's very important not to establish a show that is going to drain from the venue. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 people's good. 10 people would be better, right? Because we want this to be worth the venue's time. So if we were doing a show and, I don't know, we were taking more money than the venue was making from the show, that's not sustainable. And another thing is, like you said, sustain. So like, how long should someone produce one show before they start a second?
I mean, that's so subjective to like the success of the show and like the skills of the producer. And I think that's kind of what I was, you know, getting to, was just a lot of these producers don't have like the chops to be producing events, but because it's like a new show at a new venue, it's so interesting that it has the facade of being successful at mm-hmm. first, just because it's new and everyone's interested and the venue makes their money and the performers make their money and everyone's getting their life. But it's like, how sustainable is that? You know, like once the show has ran for 6 months or a year, if it even gets that far, like, are you still profitable?
But also from a consumer standpoint, I'm not going to go out of my way to, like, for example, yeah, the Vacaville shows. I'm not going to go all the way to Vacaville to see you and you.
Drag her.
If I can see. No, this is not shade.
Notice he didn't say me. He's coming to see me.
If I can see you and you on Sunday around the corner. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's when it gets to the point to where there's so many shows, but we're getting the same girls at each show. Then it's like, okay, your resources are being drained. And from a consumer standpoint, I'm like, well, I'm not going to go out of my way to see them if I know I'm going to see them at Badlands or if I'm going to see them at Faces. And then if they're there every week, then all of a sudden that kind of takes the luster and the new toy polish away from me. And I'm kind of just like, okay, girl, I'll see them next week or the week after that. So I was taking tips out of your pocket and less people coming and everything like that. So like, have you ever had that moment where you felt like you were kind of stretched out or overexerted as a queen during the week or
every day,
every goddamn day? Yes, absolutely. Yes. Well, you know, I would say too, I agree with what you're saying 100%. I feel like what we can do to avoid that is that there's a lot of shows in the area that are very duplicative. Ooh. And the fact of the matter is like, they have become very formulaic. There's so many shows that operate by the same function of like, okay, here's the show. How the hell are y'all doing tonight? Woo, here's three queens. Now we're going to do a game in the middle. And I'm totally reading my own show. But like, you know, it's like there's, you know, to give credit where credit is due, there's a lot of incredible performers out here who are doing something a little different. Like Yaya and Rosie, they're doing more of a cabaret sort of drag show, which is different than the standard drag show in the area. You know, Clive Max, another great performer around here, did a competition
followed up with drag lube wrestling, which is a concept none of us even do around here. And so it's like, you can make it profitable. You can have a million shows in the area as long as they're not following the same rubric.
Exactly.
They don't need to always be the same four performers, and then there's a game in the middle and the last four performers, and it's done. You know, like, we have, you know, I think, not to toot my own horn, but I'm going to do it. I have a show every Monday called FTLP, and it's all about, thank you so much. It's all about new and rising performers in the area, and that's something that isn't really being duplicated in other areas of the town right now, even though, if I remember correctly, you both actually hosted a similar show here, mm-hmm. That was basically doing the same thing. It was showcasing performers that were too young to even get into the bars. Mm-hmm. So, but even then, it's like, so there was only two shows in the area doing that. And so it's like, yes, of course, you can have many different shows, but you need to make sure that what you're doing isn't the same thing that everybody is doing, because no one's going to want to go. They know that they can catch it again on Thursday, on Friday, on Sunday.
And I think there's like this unspoken pressure that like you're not succeeding in drag if you don't have your own show. So I think a lot of, which is not true, by the way, like you can succeed through many different facets in drag. You don't have to have a show to like feel successful, especially if it's not something that you're like meant to do. Like if it's not if producing shows is not your passion, don't do it. Do what you're passionate about. And I feel like a lot of these people who are starting shows and then just like going through the motions of it because they see someone else do it. Like you were kind of saying, where it's like, we're following the same format. We're doing the, you know, the same lines and quotes and introductions, and then we do a game, and then we take our 15-minute intermission, and then we come back for our second. It's just like, yeah, it just feels like we're going through the motions with a lot of these events.
Well, I think you touched on something important, which is like, you don't have to produce a show to be a successful drag queen. You don't have comedians. Are you guys comedians? Yeah, you don't have to produce a show to be a successful comedian. Some people need to produce, like, I need to produce a show. And that I just have ideas, and I want to produce shows. And I think a really important thing is when you're producing a show, you need to ask yourself, why? Why am I producing a new show?
Money.
But sometimes that's the reason, right? Is but it
also, like, if you're really, like, a diehard producer, you will lose your ass.
You will lose
many
money.
Times.
Oh my God, so much money.
Like
thousands. November night of 2019. I lost $1,500 in 1 month producing shows. Just two shows. Because one show was $700, one show was $800 loss. That was because I don't make money. Like I can't book these three people. I mean, okay, so this show is different. Like, we don't know what we're making. But, like, I can't book people for a drag show and say, like, oh, could you do the drag show? Could you DJ the drag show? And then if the show doesn't sell tickets, I can't be like, I can't pay you guys, actually. I'm sorry. No. Being a good producer means you're guaranteeing the money up front, right? And so that's what I did. I guaranteed the money to my performers, and we didn't sell enough tickets, and I lost my ass on shows. Thankfully, I ate enough to get it back. But your money's gonna suffer, your performances are gonna suffer, right? I'm not alone saying that. Like, if you're worrying about selling tickets, and that's something you have to do, not something you have to do at FTLP, but it's something you're familiar with. If you have to sell tickets, now I'm worried about producing. Now I'm worried about tickets. Now I'm worried about other performers coming. Did they send their music? Is the DJ ready? Oh my God, is everything ready? Is the venue? Did they know what's happening? Oh my God, do this special drink named after me? Is it there? Like, you're worried about all these things. Obviously, that's a little bit superfluous, but you're worried about all these things, and you're not worried about your number. You're not worried about your stand-up set. I have done so many Queens and comedies where I worry about everything, and then I get up on stage right before the song starts and I know what song I'm doing, and I'm like, oh, motherfucker, I need to do 10 minutes of comedy after this, and I have not given a second of thought into what jokes I'm going to tell. That's because I'm worrying about making sure everyone else is ready, everyone else is paid, everyone else is prepared. Because that's what I do as a producer. And I'm not saying I'm the best producer, and I'm not saying other people shouldn't produce. By all means, if you want to produce, produce a show. But I think it's important to make sure that you're improving the community with your show, improving the art form of drag, improving what Sacramento drag or Sacramento comedy is, right?
And strive for longevity.
Strive for longevity, right. Like, don't try to get all of everything in the first show, all of the audience, all of the money, all of the accolades in the first show. Like, start slow, right?
Well, because a lot of these shows almost feel like pyramid schemes in that sense, where it's like, it's a get-rich-quick thing. You've got your budget from the venue, and you're like, cool, we got the money, let's go run our show. And it did really successful because it was the first one, and everyone was really interested to see how it went. And now we can do a second one at this place, or at another, at this place again, or
but
whatever.
You're shifting your goodwill to the second place.
Right, and it's just like, you're never really like honing in on one project.
Making
just,
sure it like a plant, like cultivating its life.
Right. And that would stress me out personally. Like just going from place to place to place to place and like starting over and starting over and starting over. Like for me, it's like with Nightcap, I'm like, I'm happy with that being my one thing that I developed for a long time.
I just had PTSD when you said starting over and starting like dating. Oh my God.
Since all three of you and you produce drag shows, how do you go into it making it to where like you feel secure? You're like, okay, I know there's a bunch of shows out here, but I'm putting my own flavor into this. I'm putting my own vibe into this, and this is going to be successful. How do you do that, and how do you feel when you do it, and what makes you feel like after you're done, you're like, okay, this is my baby. She's good.
Sure. Well, I feel like I'm more or less qualified to answer that one. I started my show on Monday nights several years ago when it was going under a different name, After Hours. And when I did that, you know, bar shows are a lot different than some of the other shows that I get produced around here because it's not, you're not given a budget. They provide you with a budget, but you have to prove that what you're doing is going to bring people in. It's always a numbers game, even if you're not actually producing something and getting the money yourself. And so in the very beginning, like it was literally like first show, it was me like on a street corner in full drag, just trying to wave people into a drag show. And I did that for weeks until we finally got a steady crowd. And then at that point, it becomes a matter of, I think one of the hardest things that I had to learn how to do was create a lineup that worked effectively. Like not just who is in the show and what you're doing with the people in the show, it's because it's a show that's hinging on new talent, people haven't really polished everything, who do you know that's going to pack the place? Who are you going to have be the first two performers? And then when you know it's okay to have kind of a lull where someone hasn't really, you know, perfected their stuff, you can put that person
that's
in.
Me.
But then
that's when I perform.
That's Suzette. Yeah. That's Suzette. And then it's like, okay, we've had one or two that weren't that great, so let's bring it back up to somebody I know. And it becomes this flow of trying to figure out how are you going to keep people in? How are you going to keep people invested and involved? And so at the very least, from my point of view, in basically just solely doing bar work, like it's become a matter of like, how are you going to keep people in? How are you going to choose the right points for people to like feel like, okay, this is the time for me to go get drinks and chill and then come right back around to watch the good performers again. And I hate to say like the good performers, but I guess the performers who more or less like know what they're doing and when they get on stage is going to bring people right back. It's a whole balancing act.
Well, right. Like you need the performers that are going to anchor the show. Let's say that. And there's got to be a place for newer, greener, maybe not as exciting performers like me. I'll say that. And
I mean, you're pretty exciting. You came out on a bike.
I did come out on a bike. I've gotten
That's
better.
Pretty exciting.
I've gotten
don't
better.
Sell yourself that short.
Well, but there when I started, I don't know if it was that exciting. So
does anybody start out exciting though? I'm gonna let you guys know right now, if you see like a drag performer who is brand new, they're gonna be terrible. Like even if their makeup is good or their outfit is good, everything else is awful because they haven't gotten the stage presence yet or anything.
Speak for yourself. I was gorgeous.
So Yaya was amazing from the get-go and we all strive to be her. She's an icon and I gotta.
But there's always something to work on though, right? Like maybe you start as Yaya, but then you're like, okay, I can what do you have to work on?
I got fat, so I had to learn how to sew. I had to learn how to sew because
she said I wasn't flawed, but then I ate.
Forever 21 wasn't cutting it after the first year.
That's a whole nother episode. Is Forever 21 okay for drag? H&M's not, RuPaul.
That's like your
that's
bread and butter.
Look, I'm dying on that hill. Forever 21 is okay for drag. None of this is from Forever 21, though, so yet. I'm working on a line with them. Yeah, yeah. Okay, so you answered the question. What was it? Rephrase the question for me. Okay, that's okay.
How do we make it different? How do we put our own spin on it?
How do you make the show special?
Right.
Since there's so many shows locally.
Sure. Oh, I think for me, personally, like, I did a show with Yaya we called Fierce, Fresh, and Fabulous, where it was for Thank you. It was for performers. You guys can woo too if you want. It's okay. I know you want to. I can see it. Oh, see? I could tell. It was for performers that were under 21, because if you're under 21 and you want to do drag, where do you do it? Because you can't get into a bar.
Yeah, street corners, alleyways.
Unless you're me and you sneak street into the clubs when, the first 3 years.
When you said, right, sneaking in? Yeah, sorry. I know. It's okay. We talked about it on the show. We didn't say where.
Well, I'm aging myself. There was a club back in the day called Bojangles that was 18 and over. And that's actually where I saw my first drag show. And that was where I met Taryn. That was my first drag queen, my first drag show. But that was years ago. Like,
by the way, is the oldest drag queen in captivity right now. She just turned 50. She's been doing it for like 20 years now?
Yeah, about 20 years, yeah.
I think you might have unplugged your mic. Okay.
My voice carries, it'll work.
For me, that's what it always is like what's missing from the scene, because people, I always do think about that. Like, people can go see the Sunday showcase, they can see Fridays Are a Drag, they can, at this point, they can see the Thursday night show. What can't they see? What can I add to the scene that's going to make them say, okay, you know what? If I'm only going to see one show this week, I want to see that one. And so I've done Fierce, Fresh, and Fabulous with Yaya. I want to do Bus Stop. I'm a dork.
Are you going to get a Sprinter?
Am I going to get
what? What the fuck bus are you going to
get? Are you going to get a Sprinter?
I don't know. I thought a school bus.
Fix your car first.
I thought a school bus would be cute. But then I thought probably a party bus, because you can serve alcohol on a party bus. Okay. I actually want to do a show with Apple that I've been like, that's Apple in my relationship is just constantly me being like, can we do it? Can we do it? And her being like, sure, one day. Please go away. Right.
And then me and Apple meet when you're not there and we're like, how do
we kill her?
Or would it be like a drag taxi cab confessions, but on a bus with performances?
I mean, well, that's Bus Stop. That's Bus Stop. Okay. The one I want to do with Apple is actually called, it's called, what are we calling it? Fake Geek Girls, Nerd Shit. We want to do Fake Geek Girls. It's Fake Geek Girls : Nerd Shit. So it'd be a show with nerdy themes. So like, okay, this one is Avengers, West Coast Avengers. Your number has to be a West Coast Avengers number. If it's not, get the fuck out. Don't bring to me who's not a West Coast Avenger. Don't bring Iron Man to me. Oh my God, the Marvel geeks are big. He was a West Coast Avenger in 1987.
First of all, thank you. Second of all, I don't even know what a West Coast Avenger is.
Okay, so like if the show is like Buffy theme that month, right?
Okay,
like,
okay. Thank you. Speak
give
my
me
language.
A good Willow number. Don't come with a bad Willow.
Skin somebody on stage. If you're not skinning somebody on stage, you're not doing drag.
It's not a Willow number.
That's just a fact.
It's not. Give me a Giles number. Oh my God, a king doing a Giles number?
Just an old Brinkley librarian who just, yes. That would turn me the fuck on.
Buffy fans in the audience? Woo! No?
One.
Who?
Good.
You've never been
you
to a drag
have an
show,
angel
you're not
number
Buffy
two.
Fans.
We what?
You have to have an angel number two.
Oh yeah, with the
I'm
ridiculous forehead.
And then
yes.
Suzette would be Cordelia.
I love
oh,
that
yes,
our
thank you,
I love
thank
that
you.
Our show I, yes. where we're talking about there's too many drag shows.
We're
just planning more
drag
shows.
I'm the worst. I am the worst. But
also, shout out to you for being like, who knows Buffy? And nobody say anything. You're like, let's keep talking about
yeah,
Buffy.
I know. Oh my God.
Read the room, baby.
This is why I'm single and why the Proud Boys hate me. Because
they're Buffy fans?
They're not Buffy fans, and I just talk about Buffy, and I'm like, oh my God, have you seen it? Season 2 is kind of slow, but like season 3 picks up, and they're like, we hate the everythings.
But honestly, if the Proud Boys hate you, that means you're doing the Lord's work.
What was that? Oh, you
yes.
agree with
Clifton. If the Proud Boys hate you, you're on the right side of history.
I know. No, I hate them too. It's they recognized me yesterday. We're getting way off topic, but they recognized me. And I was like, I know you recognize me. I recognize you. It's cool. I'm pretty. Whatever. but so that's what I tried to get back to the topic at hand. I try to find what can we do that's not being done? So how do you make sure when you started Callback, the Callback Bar, Nightcap at the Callback Bar, how did you and Rosalia Valentine, your co-producer, and your co-life?
Sexual.
Your co-sexual? Okay.
My co-sexual, yes.
Yeah, co-sexual.
Once again.
Are you homosexual? You're a homosexual?
little bit.
So oh, wait. How many gays are on this stage? I'm confused.
That's a different episode of Say Yes. Do drag performers need to be gay? But for today.
Yes, Suzette, do they?
I
think you need to have been fucked in the ass at least once.
That's a different episode. That's a different episode. That you guys will have to come back. Because right. Do you have to be fucked in the ass to do drag?
She agrees.
She's acknowledging. Yeah. Okay, audience. You're thinking right. about it. But for this one, back to producing.
Yes.
How did you and your co-producer, how did you go into it saying, we're going to make this show different?
Right. So Rosalie and I had been doing drag for several years, obviously prior to doing Nightcap. And we always just felt like our style of drag like worked in the clubs, but we would have to tweak it a little bit to make it work in the clubs. I think both of us are a little bit more goofy, a little bit more sultry, more like look oriented. And sometimes in the club, it's all about an 8 count, dancing the house down. And so there's like a lot of pressure to deliver stuff and top 40 that you necessarily wouldn't do otherwise. Which like I still love doing that. Like I love doing Thirsty Thursdays for that reason. It's always a good opportunity for me to like bust out some dance music and try that. But we wanted something where we felt like we could just be ourselves in our space and like not have the pressure of being in a nightclub. So we wanted to start a show that was like more cabaret, more sultry, more intimate than a nightclub experience. Especially too, because like a nightclub isn't inviting for all people. Like I know lots of straight people or people in my personal life that are like, oh, I could never go out to a nightclub or a gay bar. Like, that's so intimidating. And our show, like, the stakes are a lot lower than, like, going to a gay bar, you know? Like, it's more comfortable. It's kind of like just being at a restaurant. And, like, you know, it's more peaceful than being in a gay bar.
They get to be all masked and be like, yeah, I just saw a show at the Comedy
right,
Spot.
Right, yeah, I went to the bro.
Oh,
yeah.
I'm not allowed at
chicken
the
tenders
spot.
And a Red right. Bull.
Yeah, they don't like me.
Right, the chicken tenders slap, by the way, over at Punchline. Where,
Punchline
chicken
are
tenders?
Oh, my God. They're, mm-hmm. like, I that is, okay, really quick. Punchline chicken tenders, the best ever? Mm-hmm. Yes, no, or maybe?
I've never had their chicken tenders. I
okay, yes.
On that. Okay.
Just, yes. Chicken tenders yes, they're the best.
We're just derailing it and talking about chicken tenders for the rest of the
really
show.
Like
we're
yes.
just going to do it.
Yes, no, or maybe.
Yes.
Yes, no, or maybe.
Yes.
And these little pretzels good. That look like uncut penis.
Uncircumcised.
Mm. We've gone way too off course.
Pretzels?
Yes.
But that's
how
okay.
We
can get off course.
How
we get off course.
You're right. You're right. You're right.
We can get off course.
How do we get here?
Proud Boys, pretzels, uncircumcised.
But
what,
yes,
Proud
intimate.
Boys, pretzels, and penis. That's the PPP loan.
Oh,
right there.
They're at
okay.
home getting so
we have a statement from a random audience member.
Okay.
Can I approach?
Please, yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
You have to speak into the mic.
Hello.
Hello.
I just want to say, like, I think that, like, you and Rosalia, Yaya, you and Rosalia are, like, one of the, like, perfect pairings to do a show. Because you are, like, you're both opposite, I feel like. At least, yeah, and you're opposite, and you,
in their drag aesthetic,
and yes,
and, I'm good, and she's bad, right?
And
the and co-sexual is angry at home.
Your idea, like I feel like, I mean, I guess it helps that I know you guys, but like your ideas are like you mesh well, and like your cabaret like vibe for Punchline makes total sense to me. I feel like that is something that like over so many other shows, yours is one that like I would actually want to see.
Thank you.
Yeah, you can't get that at Badlands, can't get that at Faces, can't get that at any of the places.
Well,
you guys have a good formula.
And that's and how many have you done? We're coming
I think
up
this
a year.
Is
a year?
Yeah, it's going to be a year in October. November?
Okay, cool. So I got
so,
booked before
yeah,
a year was up.
It's been like almost a year of sold out shows.
And that's important. Thank you. Thank you. She was snapping for you. What's your name? Carolyn. I like how you said it. Carolyn. What do they call you? Well,
oh,
fuck
that.
Them.
Kill them immediately.
Fuck,
kill them
yeah,
immediately.
Run them over with your fucking car. That's weird.
But she named you,
named
right?
You?
Okay.
Okay. We.
Okay.
That's a different episode.
She was.
Let's
that,
get you up here.
And
we're
gonna
unpack that for a couple minutes.
Yeah. Okay, all right. That's lots of questions after the show. But okay, so you've done it's July, so you're in October.
Right.
So you've done 9 shows?
Right.
Okay. And they've all been sold out.
Yes.
And they've all been successful. The venue's happy with you.
It's hard though. And
what's hard?
And I don't want to like air out like how my show is structured. Like,
but let's fucking
with,
do
with
it.
With my, you know, but like working with Live Nation is a very hands-on experience.
Yes.
Live Nation produces like millions of events
yes.
in the
They're
country.
Worldwide. The world.
The whole
They're
world. So I am left to my own devices in a lot of areas where I have to promote it myself and I have to talk about it myself. And I designed the poster myself and I cast it myself and I, you know, handle the budget and the finances of it myself. And that has taught me to like how to really be a show producer, because those are things that I don't think a lot of these show producers even have to think about. I think they kind of put a lot of that in the venue's hands, which is why there's not necessarily longevity in some of these events. But with this, it's like I have to be invested in my show every single day of the month
yes.
in order for it to sell out.
Yes.
I have to check in on ticket sales every single day. Yes. I have to make sure it's running on Facebook and Instagram and Twitter. And then if I run an ad, I have to make sure I'm deleting every comment from the homophobic Arkansas
well,
people.
I leave them to respond.
Yeah, it's a lot.
Well, and someone, and God forbid someone drops out
I
on you.
I saw an advertisement yes. for your show on Grindr.
Oh.
Did you put it
on Grindr?
Yes, girl. It was on Grindr. I meant to screen cap. I'll screen cap
it
next time.
What?
And I was like, yes.
Like on someone's profile?
No, girl. It was, you know how on Grindr when you send
Look
a message.
At you.
And then you get the advertisers to be a little game with the man running and you gotta solve the puzzle. So it wasn't the
I
man
hate
running.
Because nobody pays for Grindr. They always gotta do the ads, yeah. right? Yeah.
So then it was that, and then the next time I sent a message, I got an advertisement. It was your show at the Punchline.
Period.
Well,
that's
hey.
So cool.
You made it. You're on the dick app.
There's
Yay.
A gay man 6 feet from you and watch the show. Yes. Well, good. Okay. So, okay.
Yeah, I'm a screen cap it next time. And send
okay.
It to you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank
so, you. So that is a very real thing for you and me, because I also produce a show at Punchline, and then this show, I've never had a show. Outside of the shows I do at the bar at Badlands, I've never had a show with a budget. I mean, okay, there was a show at a salon. I did a show at a hair salon, and that had a budget. And then I do this cute little kid show, which you've both done with me, and I get a budget for that. But Punchline doesn't say like, "Hey, Suzette, here's $1,500. Go ahead and do a show." I'm like, "Oh shit, I just committed $1,500. I hope I can pay everybody. Otherwise, I'm not gonna pay my rent." Like. And I can't suck that much dick.
Have you sucked any dick?
That's a whole different episode.
Okay. Episode 2. Has Suzette sucked dick and how much?
Well, and do you have to have a Grindr
for
to have...
much?
For how much, yes.
For how much? Are we auctioning my dick sucking off?
Yes, we are.
Look, I just want
to
say...
You
I...
said no to the dude with the vineyard. We're going to get into that, too.
I do stand up about that dude and you every time.
Please.
You haven't heard it. Look, I just want to say right now my
I'm
aesthetic...
shocked.
About what?
Just
everything?
Yeah.
That's my aesthetic. It shocks people. Yeah. That's. Am I wrong?
Yeah, but not in the right way.
I didn't say in any particular way. I just said it shocks people. I just want to say right now I'm giving private flight attendant to Ibiza, and I give really good head at 30,000 feet. That's my aesthetic. I didn't say it's reality.
We're going to unpack later what brought you to that. We're going to unpack that later, yeah.
So Grindr ads aside, you have to work so hard to promote your show.
No, absolutely.
Right. And at Punchline, I also am just killing myself every month to promote the show, produce the show, make sure I was just complaining about this shit today. I'll send a message to you guys have never been to you don't know who I am. So okay, you've been to my show. I do a show at Punchline and it's called Queens and Comedy and it has comedians and it has drag queens. It's a lot of fun. They've done it. They've been And before, maybe 2 or 3 weeks before the show, So I should do it today, actually. I'll send a message to everyone in the show. Hey, thanks for doing the show. Just sending a group message. If you want to opt out of the group message, that's cool. Don't worry about it. But I just need to say a few things. Comics, hit me with your walk-up song, because comics have a walk-up song, right? Hit me with your walk-up song. Also, if you can give me your Venmo handle, I'm just going to make sure everyone gets tipped, because people get tipped at my show also. That's how I'm going to pay you. Drag queens, hit me with your performance song. Hit me with your Venmo handle, please. Any other questions, go ahead and ask the questions here. Call time is this. The venue is this. I'll be there at this time. Thank you so much. Right? Some people message me with their song and their Venmo handle that day. Some people wait until the day of the show to hit me with that information. And I'm like, this is too late. This is too late for me. Like, I've already printed the Venmo sheet. I had to. That's okay. Sorry, was it a ghost? Me. Was it you? What happened?
It's a haunted drunk. I'm sorry.
It's the Venmo ghost.
On that note, like, I think a lot of these producers get, like, complacent, too, because if I went to a venue and they were like, here's $700, a show happen. Like, maybe the first few months I'd be like, okay, let me really hustle and get this thing going. But then if they were just giving me $700 every month to put on a show or every week, like, I feel like I would stop working as hard as I have to now just because, like, the money's there. But then at that point, it's like, now your venue is paying you $700 for an audience of five people, I've done those shows where it's like,
you're doing it right now.
Yeah,
where they're like, we're gonna pay you $200, and I show up and there's three people in the audience. I'm like, okay, well, I know you're not making any money, and now I feel terrible.
I said that to the last time I did the children's show. So if there are Proud Boys watching, they're so mad at this. I do a show for children, right? Because the real truth about, like, drag queen story time is nobody wants it. Nobody wants to watch someone read a book. Like,
I don't even know how to read.
The last show, I read them a Tom Clancy novel. Like, I read them to Clear and Present Danger, and the kids did not. They were not into. I read all 875 pages, and they just didn't. No, I'm kidding. But
every couple hours, I was like, Suzette, stop. She's like, no, kidding.
I was like, no, we haven't gotten to bus stop yet. But
and now all those children are in therapy.
They are. Yeah. I caused a lot of therapy. Yeah, that's also my aesthetic. But it causes therapy, ride spikes. So we did the children's drag show, and I actually, like, got really concerned with the venue, and I was like, did you guys make money? Because they gave me this is one of the rare shows where I got a budget, and they just paid for all the performers, and they paid for the DJ, and they were like, here's the money for the show. You don't have to do anything but show up and host it. And I was like, but are you making money? Are you? And they were like, what? And I was like, no, look, I'm getting paid, and that's great, and I love it, because this is the one show where I can just chill and actually worry about my performance, worry about what I'm hosting, worry about what I'm wearing for once, because sometimes I need help. But thank you, Liz. And yeah. But, like, I wanted to make sure they were making money. And they were like, why are you asking? And I was like, because I don't want you to go in the hole on this. Like, I don't want you guys to lose money. And they were like, yeah, we're making money long term, and that's good enough for us.
Well, and, like, to piggyback off of that, too, it's like, if us as drag performers are going to venues in the area saying, give me $700 to produce a show, and we keep doing that, and the shows become less and less and less successful, we're going to, like, establish this reputation in the community where it's like, drag performers are price gauging us, and we don't want drag shows anymore, and we're going to go from having, like, seven shows a week to nothing, because we're going to piss off every fucking venue in the city by taking all their money and putting them in the hole.
Not producing results.
Right.
Yeah. So that is important. Like, and we're not, I think none of us would say, like, no one should ever produce a show. But earlier we talked about, you mentioned the chops to produce a show. What are the chops to produce a show?
So I think oftentimes, too, like, people want to produce a show. They want to have their vision come to life, which is totally appreciated. Like, I totally get that. But in producing a show, you also have to host the event most times. And,
or hire a host, either way.
Right. And I think a lot of performers forget the, like, day of part. They're, like, leading up to the event. They're so excited for it. It's like, okay, but once you're on the mic, can you actually run a show and perform and drag on the spot? And there's a lot of hosts, no shade, that are struggling.
She's talking about exactly who you're talking about.
To get through a show.
Is us? Is she talking about us?
She's talking about us.
Yeah.
Oh. No.
Fuck her. But that's and another so show. It should everyone host? But like that is part of producing. No, is absolutely. Who's hosting your show?
Yeah, and I mean, there's even times where I'm like, I feel like I suck on the mic, and then I feel bad. I'm like, why am I producing events when the second I get on the mic, I'm like, hi, welcome to show.
That's exactly how she hosts.
Right, you. And there's just so many shows where I'm like, this is going on too long. The banter on the microphone is awkward. We're taking too many breaks. There's dead air. If you're going to be a show producer, you actually have to know how to like run your show as it's going. Like,
well, and I'm curious to know, especially from Clifton, who is outside of the actual producing aspect, what do you think makes a good host for a show?
Actually be on the stage hosting?
Oh, that is a real thing.
Yeah. Like, there'll be so many people who are at the DJ booth just like, weren't they great? And it's like, God, what's up?
Upstairs, right? Yeah. Outside, down the street.
And you should be funny.
But let me say, as someone who is or is not funny, you don't have to be funny. You just need to be engaging.
Yeah.
Because I've seen hosts that aren't funny. Does it help? Abso-fucking-lutely. Funny is good, right?
And you have to kind of sacrifice a little of like, yourself when you're hosting.
What do you mean?
Because there's stuff I say on the mic that I'm like, I would never just say this in conversation. Like the intros and you know, doing like a roll call of your audience and selling alcohol and all of those things are not like built into my character as a person. So you kind of have to sacrifice a little of like...
You're talking about like the drag-isms. Where
right,
it's just
absolutely.
Kinda, yeah.
Like you, and sometimes
can
it's
you
just...
Define
like the more we drink or the more you drink, the prettier we look and all that bullshit
it
that we say every
show. It takes
a
lot of money to look this cheap.
Right.
And sometimes that stuff gets really played out, but it's like part of a drag show. And you have to like find ways.
How the fuck are you, Badlands?
You're right. Yeah. Are y'all ready for a fucking? Are y'all ready for a fucking drag show?
She just left Badlands. She messaged. Yeah. She's on her way.
So, and if you're like not good at those things, or you can't like come with like new plays on those traditions, like you're probably gonna struggle
tropes,
a little bit.
Tropes.
Yeah.
So let's say somebody comes and they're like, okay, I saw your show. I saw Say Yes, and I want to produce a show, and you awful fucking bitches said maybe and no and no and maybe. So I want to produce a show. I'm going to make sure it's different, right? So that would be additive to the scene. I'm going to worry about the host. What else do they need to worry about?
Making sure that it doesn't feel like a cookie cutter, because I swear if I get up to another show and it's the three acts, and then we have a lip sync, then we have a twerk off, and then the same three acts again. And if those three acts are the same girls that are performed on Tuesday or Wednesday or Sunday or something like that, then it's going to feel like, okay, girl, I done seen this. And then 6 out of 10, sometimes they overdo the same number they did on Sunday, mm-hmm. on a Friday.
Jackie.
And it's just like, okay, girl, I done seen this. This is the same pattern. I know what's going to happen. And then, you know, it's just like, okay, what are you bringing different? Like, I like the Monday formula because it's something different. I like the formula you have. You have a different formula too. Like, you guys, and you have a different formula too because you book girls that we don't see all the time. It's like everybody has some, you four have something differently that you bring. However, when, if it's a Friday night, like today, there's what, one, two, how many shows were there today? Just today only?
Oh, okay.
Three.
So there was one, two, three. This technically would be four.
Yeah.
Four drag shows tonight.
Mm-hmm. And so, like, from a consumer standpoint, there's four drag shows in one night. What are you going to do differently than the other show across the street?
Get
or the
I'm going to suck dick.
Corner?
I'm suck dick. I'm everyone's dick to make sure everyone
suck
has a good
dick.
Time.
I'm going to get a stationary bike. You laugh, but...
She doesn't have a car, so she has to.
Yeah, it's. Yeah. I don't go anywhere. I just pedal in one spot. But, okay, so that's an important question because I like sports, and that's always a thing. And sports fans? Okay, so which sport? Baseball. So expansion in baseball. Are there enough players? We want to add a team in Norfolk, Virginia. Like, are there
sports analogy?
Okay, what
I'm
you
going make? Home.
Okay, you know what? I'll give it.
We're
gonna
let them have it because she's connecting with the crowd in heterosexual ways. So we're gonna let this happen.
Another good analogy. Is,
are there enough? I guess my question is: are there enough consumers? You said consumers. Are there enough consumers? And are there enough performers?
I feel like with
to sustain that,
the Monday shows are bringing more.
Monday shows are different because there's new performers. Mm-hmm. But for a Friday, a Thursday, a Sunday, a Saturday, are there enough performers to? Because what I'm having trouble with lately is like I do the Thursday show at Badlands. Mm-hmm. I'm having trouble booking it.
We need more girls.
And we can't just make
but
them.
But good girls.
Good girls. They have
and
boys.
Boys.
Absolutely.
Yeah, we need more
performers.
I will say, because of the oversaturation, I feel like we're producing all these drag people to do more drag, and there's no time to like get good at it because they're just fucking working so hard. Like when I started doing drag, it was like I would do one or two shows a month. And in between those shows, I was making new looks. I was coming up with new numbers. I was in the studio making mixes. Like, I had time to really perfect what I was doing. And now it's like, oh, you own a wig? I have a show for you on Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday and Friday and Saturday and Sunday. And I need you to do brunch on Sunday too. So you have to be good right now. And it's just like no one has the time to like get good now. So we just kind of have a bunch of like half-assed drag performers running around town doing half-assed drag.
And I will add to that, because I feel like as you know, both of us, people who have done drag for years now, I think we fall into that too, where it's like we become so busy doing all these shows.
Yeah, I phone it in so much now.
Right.
Because I have no time.
Yeah, and it's like you don't want to. You want to give a good show every time you're on stage, but if you're doing like 4 to 5 shows a week and you have no time to come up with anything different, get new outfits, get new looks, provide new like entertainment, it gets hard because you'll notice that the newbies, the ones who have more time to kind of chill and like get stuff together, they're going to start like doing things better than you. And then you're like, well, shit, now I got to catch up and find some time to do all that stuff.
So I guess to make it specific to the overarching theme of this episode, is it a producer's job to book in a specific way that doesn't cause that?
I feel like since there's so many queens and kings and performers here, I feel like it should be your duty to be like, okay, if they're performing on Sunday brunch, maybe I should not book them this week. Maybe I should book someone else and then book them the next week. So then it feels special. And then they have enough time to come up with a new number, come up with a new look, a new everything. Because there's nothing worse from a consumer. If I see you perform on Sunday and then I come out on Friday, I'm like, wait, didn't you just do this on Sunday? Like, we've all have seen that before and it happens. But like, there's enough of y'all to where that shouldn't be happening.
Yeah, and I think another thing too is like if you are going to produce events, you have to be able to hold your castmates and your people you're producing with accountable. You know, I have performers that show up late and like a lot of people just like sweep that under the rug. I'm like, you were fucking late and I'm not going to book you again because of that. And I just come out and say that because it's like I say it because I love you and I wanted you on the show for a reason. And if you are going to be working in this industry, like, we have to hold each other accountable. And, like, if people are showing up to shows doing half-assed drag, being late with bad concepts and not doing their job, like, we have to do our job and, like,
it is
making sure that the show is running well behind the scenes and on stage.
Right, and it is a job, and I think a lot of people don't think about
they
it
they don't
like
want
to
do it.
Well, but, like, this is the best job there is.
Right.
Yeah. We're literally getting paid to play dress up. That is
right.
Fucking
like,
cool.
It's an
yeah.
amazing fucking job. And if people don't, like, as a producer, that is a pet peeve of mine. If you don't want to treat this, like, have fun with it. We're getting paid to play dress up. But also, please treat it with the respect and dignity that it, because it is a job. And I need you to come and I need you to do your job. And I need you not to treat it like it's a joke.
Right.
Unless your aesthetic and your aesthetic is a joke, then, like, treat it like a joke, but treat it like a joke professionally.
Right.
I think. You guys, does that make sense?
But if the show's supposed to, we all know the joke about drag time, but if the show's supposed to start at 8 o'clock and y'all are not starting until 8:45,
okay.
8:50,
okay.
9 o'clock, then I'm going to be like,
hold
okay,
on.
Girl.
Suzette.
But if I may piggyback off of that, I feel like that's kind of, it's like a drag performer versus audience sort of situation. Because there are a lot of times where the drag performer or the audience are like, oh, okay, well, I know it's a drag show. They're not going to start until da-da-da, so I'm not going to show up until da-da-da. And then it's like, we start late because the audience doesn't go there. So it's like a push and pull there.
Yeah.
Where I don't know if that's really ever going to get resolved. I think you're always going to see a drag show late because it's either the audience hasn't arrived or the drag performers are late. It's
I've been there times where you have been ready And we were, you were just like, oh, push it back because there's no one there. Because
there's like four people there and I'm trying to get more than $3.
Different shows are different things. So like the Friday night show, like I intro'd off the Friday night show because I was hosting the viewing party night. And that very much is a we need an audience to do the show. And the audience is like, yeah, but we're not going to come out till the sun's down. So it's like, all right, I guess we'll wait until 8:45. And would we love to wait until 10 o'clock? Fuck yeah, absolutely. But then people aren't going to come until 11. So it's like, it's very much pushable. Thursday, though, my Thursday show, Thirsty Thursday at Badlands, we start right the fuck on at 11.
And it's
like, I don't care where, if we have an audience or not. We're because and that one is because of the go-go's, because we have go-go's at 10:30, and then we're on 11, and then we're off at 11:30, they're on 11:30, and then we're back on at midnight, and then they're off at midnight, and so we are on the clock. Like, and I've had it before, early when I was doing Thursday shows, there was one Thursday night where it was 10:59, and I was the only drag performer, and like in the building, and I was like, I don't know what the fuck to do. I guess I'll do one number and call it good, but I was like, this isn't that show where we're starting late because we're starting late. So, okay, we're kind of running up on the end of the episode. What do we want to say? What do we want our lasting kind of words to be about producing a show?
Be passionate about producing and putting on shows. Right. Don't just do it to feel like you're doing what you're supposed to do. Like, be passionate about the process and about connecting with your audience and with your performers and really making an event that is conducive to like being profitable and successful and long lasting. Don't just do it because you saw someone else do it and you feel like now you have to do it so people take you seriously. Like, do it because you love it.
Right, because like I really do love producing shows, and you pegged that on me. Like, you pegged me, you said that about me. Like, I mean, you
said, don't talk about that.
We don't talk about that. But you said that about me, like, early on when we were becoming friends, like, you like producing. And I do. And
right, and no shade, like, I think of you as, like, a producer first. Like,
I think everyone does.
Yeah, because you, that's what you do. Like, you,
right.
Because I remember one of the first times I met you, you were at fucking Badlands handing out, like, fans with your flyer for the show on it. Like, you would clock the fan, and it had the show flyer. And there was a whole other show going on inside the club. And she was on the patio, like, promoting her show for the next night. And I'm like, that's probably taboo. You probably shouldn't do that. But, like, I was just like, damn, this bitch is a fucking hustler. And I did not like her when I first met her.
You hated
me. I was like, this ugly straight man did not just tell me this.
What?
Yeah.
You just outed her. How dare you?
Yeah.
How dare you?
But then when I saw you out every fucking day promoting your shows and hustling like you were, I was like, okay, I have mad respect for this person.
I'm not ugly.
Apple, what's your what are your thoughts?
I mean, wow, gosh, yes. lovely segue, thank you. You know, I would say, and I think a lot of this comes from me doing the Monday show and just having a certain spot in my heart for people just wanting to do something new. If you want to host, if you want to produce a show, you know, there's nothing against giving that a shot, for sure. But, like, just make sure that whatever you do, it's something that is unique, something that people want to see that isn't something that they see all the time. And at the very least, like, you know, I might even recommend before you produce your own show, maybe, like, ask a performer who does a show, like, hey, can I do, like a guest hosting spot sometime? Or could I get on the mic for a little bit? Just to, like, make sure that you have the chops for it. And then once you do, the world's your oyster. Go nuts with it. Just make sure that what you're doing's exciting, you know?
And, like, that's the thing. Have a passion about it.
Yeah.
Like, that's what you were saying, basically. Have a passion. Make sure it's exciting. If it's not exciting to you, if you're doing it because it's rote, because you think it's the next step, why? Like, figure out.
Right.
Learn some other step. Learn how to sew.
Because I can tell when you're not into it. I can tell when people are not into what they're doing and they're doing it just for a check or a tip or notoriety,
awkward.
Because it would just have that kind of stale feeling. And from an audience perspective, I'm like, okay, they're not really feeling it. They're just kind of going through the motions. And that will be your downfall, and you'll be gone in a couple months. So
yeah, and the fact of the matter is you have to be ready for any fucking audience. You need to act like three people is 20 people, is 40 people. because it's like you're gonna have days like that. You're gonna have days where you're gonna, you know, you're in a tiny comedy theater and you're on microphones and you're staring at an audience of maybe like 5 or 6 people, mm-hmm. and it's gotta still be. Thank you guys so much for coming out. You're amazing, by the way. Thank you. You gotta act like it's a full crowd. You gotta act like you're serving everybody because people came to have a good time, and it's not their fault that not everybody showed up. You gotta act like it's a big fucking deal, and not everybody can do that.
You gotta give that same energy. That's the same energy that you would give 200 people, you give to the 20 people.
That's a hosting pet peeve. That's a different episode, but I hate when people admonish the audience that came. Like, well, you guys aren't a big crowd. Well, how about just being happy about the crowd that came? Thank you guys for coming. Like, it's not your fault other people aren't here. Like, thank you guys for coming. We're not going to talk about, like, the people that aren't here because fuck them. Like, so let's talk about you guys. You know, let's talk about baseball.
We're going to turn it to you, and we're just going to ask you about your life stories for the next half.
No, but like, I just, it is a pet peeve of mine when hosts are like, where's the rest of the, like, they ask the crowd where the rest, like, they know. Like, the people that are, they're laughing because it's true. People do this shit. They're like, where's the rest of the crowd? I don't know them. I don't know. I don't know where they are. Home?
I could call someone.
Yeah, I guess. I don't, did you, yeah, like, what the fuck? Like, that happens, though.
Oh, yeah. And my other word of advice to people producing shows, get really good at Microsoft Excel because you're going to have the IRS up your fucking ass. So you got to keep track of everyone you're paying, every move you make, all the ads you run on Facebook.
Every move you make.
Like I do this shit for real. I've got my spreadsheets.
I have your spreadsheet. Mm-hmm. I have a spreadsheet, yeah.
I cut 1099s, bitch. I don't play around.
How are you both gay and good at finances? That doesn't normally add up.
Jew.
True. It's because I'm Jewish. There you go.
Yeah. So, okay. So, Clifton, if someone's going to... Did you give your last words on producing a show?
I feel like if you're going to produce a show, make it feel special. Put your whole heart, soul, foot, pussy, whatever genitalia you identify
your
with
foot pussy?
Into it. Yeah. Yeah, your foot.
Your pussy.
Your pussy.
Pussy, yeah.
Put everything into it because
my pussy's wet.
I can tell because I have seen plenty of drag shows, and I've been to shows where the performers are not feeling it and we feel it. But I have been to shows where there's only been about 30 of us in there, but y'all are feeling it, y'all are having a good time, and it doesn't feel like there's only 30 people in there because we're having a good time, we're engaged, and we're into it. We're throwing all our money to you. We're going to the ATM to get more money to throw at you, like that. Those are the good shows. Like, you know, every show's not going to have 100 people. Every show's not going to have packed to capacity lying around the corner. But it's just how you make us feel is what makes your show. And if you can give us that good feeling and make us go home and tell our friends about this and post about it on our Instagram stories and stuff like that, you got a show.
I agree with everything you guys said. It's about passion. And for me, it really comes down to why are you doing the show? Why are you producing? Because, like, you guys know I'm a dork. You guys at this point know I'm a dork. You know I'm a dork. But I have a whole, like, syllabus because I actually wanted to teach. I think I've talked to you about this. I wanted to teach a seminar on producing a show because, like, for me, it is very much like a formulaic science.
What if we did a show where we taught people how to do shows? On a bus.
Look who's producing. Oh, you're making
not on a bus. Is it a double decker like on Spice World?
This was a targeted attack on Alpha.
Yeah.
I messaged one of the party bus people and they never messaged back. And
if it looks like the inside of the Spice World bus, I'm so fucking here.
Oh, now you're in?
Yeah.
If it's got the Baby Spice swing, yeah, I'll teach
now
stuff.
You think
on the
baby
if it's got
swing.
The baby, yeah.
Of course it's got the Baby Spice swing. No, but like. I think the first question on the syllabus for the seminar, that's a lot of S's, is like, why are you doing? Are you doing this? Because you only produce a show for certain reasons. You do it for money, right? You do it for clout. A lot of people want to do it so they get their name out there. Guilty. You do it because the venue wants it, or you do it because the area needs it. Like it really breaks down to those four reasons. So what's the reason?
You can't do it because you like it. It's just those four reasons.
No, I mean, you can do it because you like it, but you're not going to produce a show because you like it. You're going to produce a show for one of those reasons. And I think it's really just – it's important to be honest about what the reason is, right?
Absolutely.
Because if you're doing it for clout, say you're fucking doing it because you want people to know who you are. You know, if you're doing
it – there's no shame in that.
Absolutely
like
not.
Like, if your objective
absolutely
is to
not.
Go out and put your name out there, then fucking do it.
But just produce a good show, because if you're not going to produce a good show and you want to get your name out there, then just get booked. Just get booked and perform, right? Yeah. I just heard noises. Okay, cool. Like a.
I just heard noises. No, that's just your psychosis shit going on. You're
fine. Oh, okay.
You're
that's
good.
A,
you're good.
Okay, I have a lot of psychosis, but like, be honest about why you're doing it, and then do it with your whole heart, like we said. You know. So okay. So any is that it? Are we good?
Do we take audience questions?
Any audience questions on this topic? First of all, thank you guys again for being here.
Yeah, give yourselves a round of applause. You were incredible. Thank you so much. Very attentive, very interactive.
I want this to work. I think we all want this to work, and it only works with audience because we care about the venue. And if we don't have any audience, then the venue's like, so you want to do this on Tuesday at 9 a.m.? And that's a no for drag performers.
That's a hard no. Yeah.
Nope. What's your question?
No. Not really a question, but I feel like if you're producing a show, it should be a little bit of everything that all of you said. It should be a little piece of all of it, honestly. And if someone says it's not, then you're probably lying. But like, I feel like it's more important where, like, what's the reason that you want to keep it going? Like, I feel like that reason is a little bit more important than the other ones. But like, but at the end of the day, like, when you're starting one, it's probably a mixture of all of it, right? So
it can be, because I've started many shows. I've started shows where the venue was like, "Hey, you know, we want this show," and I'm like, "I don't know if that show should be a show." And they're like, "But we want it," and I'm like, "Okay, cool, we'll do it." And I've started shows where, like, the kids shows, like, that's a reason in my heart. I believe kids should get to see drag. They shouldn't have to wait till they're 21. Like, they should get to see make believe people doing make-believe things for fun. Like, I've done shows to get my name out there, absolutely, because I had no name when I first started. I've done shows for money, rarely though, rarely for money, because I understand you're going to lose it. You're going to lose all – if you care about the show, you're not going to make fucking money. Like, until I get a residency in Vegas, I'm not expecting money.
Well, we have residencies in Sacramento now. Did you hear with Barbara Streisand and Lady Gaga and Madonna?
I was like, holy shit, Sacramento's come up.
I was making that all up. That was a fever.
If they Barbara Streisand Liza and back. Lady Gaga were here, there'd be no more drag shows.
Liza's back alive? Is she dead?
She's not dead.
She's not dead.
Wow, you really are.
They killed
straight.
Her and brought her back to life. I don't know. They brought Judy Garland back to life. Is she doing a show?
After a couple of edibles, she'll do any show.
Okay,
you know?
Okay, yeah. So yeah, okay. So any questions from the audience about this topic? You don't have to. It's okay.
Yeah, we don't want to put you on the spot.
Make something
up. Or statements, right. like Pocket had. He said, it's been really fun and informative. Thank you. What's your name? John, thank you so much.
John and Carolyn. Carolyn. Yeah. Fuck your mom.
Her
Carolyn.
Mom doesn't know. Yes. Does her mom know how to say your name?
Yeah. Okay.
That's fucked up.
She said
no? What's she call him?
James.
Joe. Well, that's an accent. Well, I'm okay with that. We can't get mad about the pronunciation. I'm mad that she named you a name that she doesn't know how to say. Uh-huh. What is... But you're... That didn't clear it up. I thought it
so
was
you have your
sense.
Name and you have your angry name. I like it.
So it's you have good. A drag name. Yeah.
Bring then we'll catch the you stage. On stage next week. Shoot.
Right in a show. Do you want to do bus stop? So
do you have a bus that we could use.
Yeah.
Please.
If you have a bus and you have a, we can hire. Yeah, I know.
We're making magic. We're producing.
But
yes.
let's use that as. It is a dumb idea, but let's use that on the way out of, like, it. Bus stop could exist. It's a show that doesn't exist, right? So as long as we have an idea that doesn't already exist, like lube wrestling or a bus stop show, and we have a bus and we book it well and we care about it and we don't care about money, this show could exist.
Yes.
You're not going to do it with me.
I'm absolutely not
going
to do that with you. No.
But it could exist. You'll do it with me?
No.
You'll say no, but then you're going to say yes.
No.
Yeah.
Oh, no.
This is from experience. Talking to you, I've heard so many outrageous freaking ideas.
You have to say me, Suzette.
Suzette. Sorry. So Suzette, talking to Suzette specifically, I've heard so many different ideas from you. And back in the day, I'd be like, fuck that. Like, that would never happen. However, pretty much all of it has happened. So, like, yeah.
Well, and if I can say, there's no secret to that. Like, there's no, I think some people look at me and they're like, what the, how?
Often, every day.
I know.
Yeah.
But really, it's one, it's the passion. And two, it's surrounding yourself with people that are good at what they do. Like, that's what I do. I surround myself with people that are good at what they do. And that's how my shows are successful. Like, the Queens and Comedy, I book it so well. And it's successful because of that. You guys have done it. Like, this show was important to me that, like, we did it. Because that's the best way for this show to succeed. Thirsty Thursday, like, that's a show. That's a different one. Like, that's a show that, like, Marcos and I built from the ground up. Like, so it's just, it's working with people that are good at what they do and making sure that you put your whole fussy into it. You know?
It's all about the fussy.
It's about
baby.
The fussy, and you gotta put your fussy the into fussy. It. If you're not a whole fussy, then get the fuck out.
I do wanna mention that I am a size 13, so if that's something that anyone's interested in, I got a whole
size
fussy.
Size 13 fussy.
Oh. Fussy. Fussy, get the fussy wet or get the fuck out.
We do need to stop saying we fussy. It's making me a little sick.
Is it? Yeah. So anyway, this show specifically, Say Yes. I hope that it keeps existing. I hope that these three people keep doing it with me. The next episode will be about a different topic. Studio audience, if you guys have a topic that you want to hear us talk about, go ahead and say it. You can say it now. You can message later. Audience watching, I have a whole list of topics. I've showed it to these two. And ad nauseum, just I wake Apple up and hey. Look at the list.
You
again.
Don't wake me up. I leave my phone on Do Not Disturb.
Hey, Twan.
Hey.
But, you know, we're open to ideas because we want to answer these questions because I think that's the thing. 9.5 years, 6 years, 6 years, you've been around these streets for...
God, about 15 years.
So that's that's a combined 900 years of drag experience.
Carry
I think.
The one. Yeah,
yeah, I don't know math. I'm not the Jew. But... But
yes, you are.
You're gonna unpack that too.
Okay, hold on. We got a comment. Bus stop needs a film crew to sell it. Also, someone said this is giving very Suzette Veneti show vibes. So thank you, audience, for watching. Appreciate that. And if it's giving Suzette Veneti show vibes, then I'll say because that was a show that I did with my whole heart, with people that I love, and that made it work.
And your fussy.
Yeah, I didn't want to say. I didn't want to make a mistake.
And you stayed awake for this one.
I did.
You did.
Okay, because I'm not. I haven't been up for 37 hours.
Good for
That's
you.
A good read, though.
Good for you.
I did. I fall asleep all the time on this.
Yes, you
show.
Do. Yes, you do.
But so if you guys have any things that you're like, I don't know, like one of the episodes is like, can drag queens wear sneakers? John, have you ever wondered that?
No.
No, you
the
haven't wondered that.
The answer to that is maybe.
Oh my God, that's why you love him, right? That's such a good answer.
Yeah.
Okay, but like, if you guys had questions like that, like, you know, I don't know, do drag? What another one is like, do drag queens need to know an 8 count to be a drag performer?
Well, like, and you know, like maybe at some point we could even open it to things that aren't necessarily drag related,
absolutely.
But people are just curious what drag people think about that stuff.
Do drag people think mental health is important? Something like that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I can say no because I keep doing this and I shouldn't.
Right.
Is that hanging, is this hanging out with me?
Clifton, what are your opinions?
Right.
So anyway, thank you so much to Stab for letting us do the show. Thank you to you guys for being here in the audience. Really appreciate it. Thank you anyone
thank
watching
you.
On YouTube or twitch.tv/stabcomedy. I like this show. I want to keep saying yes or no or maybe.
Yeah, well, if the audience is here, I'll do it. And if a paycheck comes here at some point, I will definitely do it.
Will you do Bus Stop?
No.
Damn it.
No.
Okay. Anyway, I will...
I'll be a passenger on the bus.
Thank you.
I'll drive the bus.
You'll drive the bus.
Give me like 3 white claws. I'll drive the bus.
In drag?
Yes.
Drive the bus straight to hell, girl.
That's right. You got to make it fun. You got to make it exciting. You got to make
do
it
white
dangerous.
Claws get you drunk, actually?
Yeah. If you know what got me drunk was those House of Love cocktails at DragCon.
Oh, girl. That, okay. There are gay cocktails called House of Love that come in a can and they will fuck you up. Oh my God.
Don't let the label fool you. Them things. Ooh.
That is not a seltzer. That is a disaster.
And on that note.
On that note, I guess I'll just say this has been a lot of fun. And for Apple Adams, Clifton Ellison, Yaya, I'm Suzette Veneti, and thank you so much. And we'll be back next first Friday of the month.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us. That is the end of our evening. Check out stabcomedytheater.com for the full calendar of events. We've got one show tomorrow at 9, Big Top Comedy, stand-up showcase. Lots of fun. Check us out there, or check us out anytime. Lots of times. Yeah, I'm dealing with the chat now. Hold on. So we'll see you back here Monday, or tomorrow. Gosh darn it, I'm confused. Have a good night. StabComedyTheater.com for the full calendar events. Have a good evening. There's some place that we can send you. Yes, Improv Revolution is doing a thing. Hold on for the raid. We'll send you guys over there.